Hello students, welcome to English class.
So today we are dealing with a story and the title of our story is Just Shoot. So before going to our chapter, let's familiarize with the author. Peter Allison. So he's an Australian author whose book focuses mainly on his experiences as a safari guide in Africa and South America. And he currently lives in Cape Town with his family. And his book, Whatever You Do, Don't Run, became a bestseller in 2008. So that's all about the author. Now, let's start our chapter. Just Shoot. So this is a story about a wildlife tour guide out on a trip with his group. Read on to find out what happens when things suddenly go out of control. Spiru Bagu made his first polite request as we set out on our vehicle. I would like to film a lion killing something. We will see, I said, as we started making our way to the camp. On every drive, Spiru Bagu tried to teach every animal how to pose. He grew frustrated when they did not understand him. So here the speaker is a wildlife tour guide out on a trip with his group. So at every beginning of the trip, Spiru Bagu, one of the passengers, politely says that he wants to film a lion killing something. And the speaker explains that on every safari, Spiru Bagu tries to teach every animal how to pose and grows frustrated when they do not understand him. Then the speaker goes on to relate what had happened in their previous safari together. On our last drive together, I saw fresh lion's track on the dirt road we were using. I stepped out of the vehicle to take a better look. Very new, only a few minutes old, I told the group, following the tracks a little farther along the soft dust of the road, it's an adult female. No, two adult females. I knew these lions. We were in territory of Martina's Pride, a group of only two adults. I suspected that one female had given birth to cubs recently. So the speaker had seen a fresh lion track on the dirt road that they were using, and the speaker is excited and he stepped out of the vehicle to take a better look, and he informed the group that the tracks looked fresh and followed the tracks a little farther along the soft dust of the road. And here speaker realized that they were in the territory of Martina's Pride. And one of the two female lions must have given birth to cubs recently. To make sure the lions had not moved into the thick bush on my left, I walked a little farther without thinking about how far I was going from the vehicle. I was hoping that the lions would be somewhere on the plains to my right, where it would be easier to spot them. So to make sure that the lions had not moved into the thick bush on his left, he walked a little farther, at hoping that the lions would be somewhere on the plains to his right, where it would be easier to spot them. Hey, I shouted back to the eager faces peering over the back of the open top Land Rover. There are tracks of little cubs here. It looked like the cubs went this way. I pointed into the bush and the adults went this way, I said, aiming my other arm out towards a termite mound. So, as the speaker shouted back to the eager faces peering over the back of the open-topped Land Rover, that the cubs had gone towards a bush to his left and the adults had gone to the opposite side towards a termite mound. Termite mound is a small hill of mud made by insects that is similar to ants for their dwelling. Okay. While I suddenly realized how stupid I was, the lion came at me. Getting between a lion and her cubs is as dangerous as crossing a busy road with your eyes and ears shut. I had just forgotten to look both ways. Martina and her sister, who I had seen ripping other animals to pieces on several occasions, were coming at me. I fell naked and cold. I now remembered my training. My arms were already raised, making me look bigger. I faced the lions, showing that I had forward-facing eyes like them. This is meant to make them hesitate. here hesitate means slow down or pause before doing something. So by the time the speaker realized his mistake, he saw Martina and her sister, both of whom the speaker had often seen raping other animals to pieces. And getting between a lion and her cubs is very dangerous. So the speaker was terrified, and remembering his training, he raised his arms to make himself look bigger and stood facing the lions to show them that he had forward facing eyes like them. This was meant to make them hesitate. They were not coming in a straight line at me, but were bouncing stiff-legged from side to side, getting increasingly closer. This is an almost sure sign of a mock charge. I was relieved to know that the lions might not kill me. They stopped about 7 meters from me and backed away. The fur along their spine was erect, their faces twisted into snarls, and low growls filled the air. So here the lion bounced stiff-legged from side to side, getting increasingly closer to the speaker. And this was almost sure sign of a mock charge, that the speaker felt relieved that the lions would probably not kill him. And the lion stopped about 7 meters from him and backed away, with the fur along their spine standing erect, their faces twisted into snarls and low growls filling the air. I took a step back. They came closer to me. I gave a roar, but it was less than threatening. They backed away, bellies low to the ground, their focus on me, mine on them. When they stopped, tails twitching, I took a step back again. They charged. Every time they kept coming at me with a bouncing run, yellow fur and a flurry of teeth. They backed off, and the last time they backed off, I stepped closer to the vehicle. So as the speaker stepped back, the lions moved closer, and here the speaker tried to give a threatening roar, but in vain. So every time the lions charged at the speaker, they backed off, and the last time they backed off, the speaker stepped close to the vehicle. Suddenly they came straight. This is it, I thought, and gave the only roar I have ever managed with menace in it. They didn't show, and it looked only a second before they were at me. So suddenly the lions went straight for the speaker, who gave a menacing roar, but that did not slow them down. The lions ran straight past before I became aware that they were not going to hit me. All that was left was their pungent odor. As they headed for the cubs they had been protecting, I wanted to sit down, but I continued slowly, shakily backing away. At the vehicle, I finally turned. Somehow the entire group had squeezed into the back seat to watch. Spiro Bagu had his video camera hanging loosely in his hand, lens cap on. He looked very displeased. So, however, the lions ran straight past the speaker and headed for the cubs they were keen to protect. And the speaker felt drained from the narrow escape and wanted to sit down. But he slowly and shakily backed towards the Land Rover. Spiro Bagu's video camera was now hanging loosely in his hand with its lens cap on. And he looked very displeased. As I fell into my seat, wanting to cry, wanting to omit, wanting to laugh and scream, he spoke. I'm sorry, but I wasn't able to get that the first time. Would you mind doing it again? So, looking very displeased, Spiro Bagu requested him to repeat the entire episode with the lions, as he was not able to shoot it the first time. So, through the story, the writer builds suspense, and the detailed description helps the reader to visualize the entire episode vividly. So the story ends with a spot of humor, as the last line puts a twist to the mood built up by the writer. So that's all about the story. I think it is clear to you. So see you in the next class with another video. That's all for today. Thank you.